what's going to happen here is we'll have a question up, you'll all answer it. We'll give you about, you know, 10 seconds or so to indicate your response, then we'll look at the response, and we can have a discussion after each and every one of them as to why the response is what it is. So hopefully it'll be very interactive, and we'll see how it goes. First question, please.
Have you intervened at a job site relative to a safety action or inaction of an employee or subcontractor?
Simple, yes or no. Okay, everybody done on that one? Let's see what we got. 78% have intervened at a job site. So my question would be on this one, what about the other 22%? Why not? Why haven't we got 100? Because I can't believe that you haven't all seen something at a job site where you should have intervened. Okay, if yes, let's go to the next question. If yes, and you intervened, was the individual's reaction A, positive, thankful, and took corrective action? B, negative, and took no corrective action? Negative, but took corrective action?
Okay, 53% got a positive reaction.
C, negative, what was that, 41? Negative, but took corrective action. And very few got a negative response with no reaction. So I guess the thing that says, intervening paid off. And corrective action was taken to correct the risky situation. Okay, next question. If you didn't intervene, so if your answer to the initial question was no, why? Why didn't you intervene? Because A, it wasn't my responsibility. Concerned about the reaction of the employee or sub, this is really for that 22%, I guess, really more than anything else. Employee subcontractor is well known as a risk taker and wouldn't accept advice. None of the above.
What's the result?
None of the above. Okay, so you didn't intervene. Was it those? Can somebody answer D? Tell me what none of the above did or what their rationale was. Nobody wants to speak up? Try to find out what's going on out there.
Ron.
Yes.
Okay, years ago, I worked on high-rise construction. Our job was to do your job. You don't get involved in anything else that's happening around you. I guess it was 20-some years ago.
Lots changed, right?
Oh, I know it's changed. But there are still old school companies out there doing high-rise concrete work and that. Nobody doesn't work there anymore. You work a lot. No respect. And you just had a guy over you all day long. And did exactly what he said. And you had to even when the word of luck at somebody else.
Yeah. So hopefully times have changed a lot in the last 20, 30 years. You know, if I think back to some of the situations I was involved in when I was working in the steel industry way back when, that was a scary business, 35, 40 years ago. And I know things are different there now. And things are different in our industry anymore. Okay, next question. Have you or do you know of an employee, supervisor, or subcontractor employee who's been disciplined for a safety infraction? Yes or no?
Okay, that should be a quick one. What's your answer? 77% said yes.
Okay, so there's discipline involved in, three quarters of the situation. Okay, let's find out what form that disciplinary action was on. Was it A, time off with pay? Sent home for the day? Less than 1 week off with no pay? Or termination?
Sent home for the day.
So it seems like the big response there was being, the employee was sent home for the day. Probably, think about what the situation you were in, the risk that you were presenting to both yourself and potentially to your coworkers as well. So go home, think about it. No repercussions. Probably a bit of coaching, which I think Mike was talking about earlier as well. And coaching is a good disciplinary form. Form to follow with somebody that isn't totally familiar with the rules and requirements. Interesting that 12% or 18% issue was that potentially resulted in termination. Somebody voted in the room.
Actually, the individual that terminated the
smoking. It's not a cardinal rule, I guess. You know,
there was a clear
infraction. Not something that's not unknown to everybody. Everybody should know. And so it's a sort of thing that not only presenting a risk to himself, but knowing some others as well. So, okay.
I remember a time when a truck with a fuel company would run super fuelers, and they did not have automatic nozzles. And the rule was you had to stay with your nozzle, or you'd be terminated. It only took one driver to be terminated, and everybody's favorite.
That's an interesting fact, because what's happened there is that by setting the example of following through on a rule that you had in place, it made it clear to the other people involved that, hey, you don't follow this rule, you're not, because it's that important that you follow it. So it is important that whatever rules you establish within your organization, that you're able to enforce the rules. The rule that you have in place that you don't enforce is a useless rule. Next question, please. Do you believe that supervisors, i.e. those who have control over another employee at a job site, know their responsibilities for safety and the potential consequences of not fulfilling their responsibilities? Okay, results? 81% say yes. For that 19% that said no, probably need to think about what you need to do to train your employees. Because if they know about their roles and responsibilities, it's a management issue as opposed to an individual worker issue. So it's something that you may want to take a moment here and think about what you can do. Next question. Whose responsibility is it that the supervisor be aware of their responsibilities? The supervisor or the supervisor's company? That's pretty even split, isn't it? The reason it's probably pretty even split is because it probably should be both. It is the responsibility of both the supervisor and the supervisor's company that they are aware of their responsibilities. So that's actually not a bad response. It is both. I'm sure that not on both of the above for this one as well. So probably would have got 100% on that one.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
If we had one, we'll get to, would it count as both?
I don't think so, Brian. Okay, this will be an interesting one. What bill in Canada defines supervisor responsibility? C-47, C-54, C-51, C-45. It's been an act for several years. Not bad. At least we got the right one with the biggest percentage. It is Bill C-45, and that's the one that the incident that Rob was speaking about earlier with the four deaths. That was the first case where somebody had been charged, as I understand it, under C-45 from supervisor responsibility. From a management perspective, it's important that you inform and ensure that your superintendents and the job sites, project managers, are fully aware of their roles and responsibilities. When Bill C-45 first came out, an awful lot of people that said, I don't want to be a superintendent anymore. I don't want to take that responsibility. So that was a case of people backed out of that role as a result of that bill. That's probably a good thing. Because you want somebody in there that actually does take their job seriously. Okay. Okay, next question. Do you believe that 100% of all workplace incidents are preventable? Wow. So is that 18% all act of God that Rob was talking about earlier? I think it was Rob you talking about act of God. That's pretty mean God. Pardon me? So I would love to know the bring it around and maybe ask the people at the table whether that 18%, because if you are, let's get on the train and get part of the 82% or whatever thing we said not to go 100%. Are you and your employees using POST as your only safety training? Yes or no?
itself is not enough. Most is just, you know, it's like getting your driver's license, which is the opportunity to get a national operator, but it doesn't, it's not enough training. So we got the right response there. I'm a little concerned about the 8%, but because it needs to be more than most. So think about that. If your answer was no, which 80% said, what other methods do you use? Internal company training, third party safety training, both of the above, or both? Both of the above. People are doing their own internal training, probably with resident experts, be it your safety officer or whatever, or other employees that are involved in safety or risky situations or had an incident and are speaking to it. They have become sort of disciples on that aspect of it and want to preach the gospel, so to speak, of what to, how to behave safely in that environment. And in some respects, there's no better teacher than somebody who's experienced an incident and is able to share the rationale and the repercussions of that incident in your family to bring it home to others and think safely about it. So, internal company training, third party safety training are both important. Third party safety training is one where you, you know, you get into something that's probably a little more technical. When you think about work at height or some of the other aspects, confined space that are a little more challenging, a little more technical. Those are the ones where you really want to bring in a third party safety trainer, where you, in some cases, seek advice from them as to what the true interpretation of any legislation may be. So, what the proposal committee did with respect to confined space, where we engaged. Again, it wasn't pension environmental who was involved in the development of the legislation to help us interpret how that applied to our industry. Okay, next question. Do you believe that your company's 35 or so written safety policies are known and understood by your supervisors and frontline workers? That's surprising. What does that say to you folks in the audience that training? So if you're part of that 31%, or if you're part of the management organization there, think about what you need to do to help that answer to call A to get up to 100%. Because all your employees need to understand their own internal safety policies in addition to ones that are required by the industry. Okay, next question. Do you personally complete at least one safety action daily to improve workplace safety for you or your employees? If your management, if you're in that 30%, I think as Rob was talking about before, the responsibilities of a manager is to walk the talk, be visible, and demonstrate your commitment and belief in the safety program that your company is in place. So 30% of you aren't doing something on a daily basis to demonstrate that. Think about changing that number. If you do something, what was the thing that you do on a daily basis? MRA test, plain job observation, job safety analysis review, or something else? Something else is the big winner here. So can people talk to me about what that something else meant? Half the people in this room voted for D. What did they do? A bunch of shy people.
I surveyed what was going on in the workplace versus doing a formal review. I was always looking at everything that was going on in the area, walking through the area, seeing how all the reviews being done.
What do you talk about?
I call it the walkthrough.
It's something that I know I used to practice a lot of times when I was going up to a job site. I grabbed the such a misrepresentation of the workplace cases. What does that say? Rob, what does that say to you? Misreporting or an actual incident? An incident? Okay. How many people in this group have participated in the incident investigations? How many different stories did you get regarding the same incident? How long ago was it to find out what really happened? How often is there a tendency to be on a witch hunt as opposed to finding facts? Don't want to be on a witch hunt. You have to drill down. My favorite tool for instant investigation is using the five whys. I think both of you have been to the safety board professor when I was there. You remember me talking about the five whys as a tool. You can dig in, you can cause, as what the determining factor may have been in the incident. So it just, CCTV cameras on our job sites are very valuable for looking into and helping understand incidents, but those would tend to be more useful on, you know, maintenance activity incidents as opposed to construction, because construction did not have that system up and operating. CCTVs, you know, your video replays are going to be very handy to help that. You've got to get the person in the loop to respond. Investigation to the cause of the matter. Make sure they identify, clearly understand, sorry, that it is not a witch hunt. We want to understand what went on so that this situation does not happen to somebody else. It's not a fear of losing your job. I'm sorry you got hurt, but make sure it doesn't happen to somebody else.
Unfortunately, that's not
what
they don't say.
It's really tough to get people to open up and, you know, admit fault, admit where it falls. But a lot of times you have to remember, make them understand it's not necessarily their fault, it's going to be a management fault. Or lack of providing the proper tools, or lack of training, or whatever. It's not necessarily the individual's fault. So you need to help them understand that. It is tough. I know from the number I've done, it is tough to get people to be open and honest with these investigations. Most of us here have supervised someone on a job site. Does post-level 2 mesh well with your learnings and experience? How many people have completed level 2? Only about half, not even half. So for those of you who have been around for a while, you should definitely be doing level 2. Well, let's have a look at this and see if it fits with your expectations or your learning experience. level of workforce training, so that's good to see. Showing some work to see putting that together and making it a useful tool to enhance our PBS capabilities on the job site. Do you believe that safety policies and safety procedures will reduce potential incidents?
Great. That's exactly where you want to be, 96%, so that's good. And I think, you know, what the 4% says is that, you know, despite having the best procedures and policies in place, there's still potentially some outliers in your organization that you potentially need to deal with. And no matter what rules and procedures you've got in place, they may not necessarily care about them or be committed to the program. So you have to work with that 4%. That's what it says to me. Personally perform land job obsolete. Is it 84 and 16 months? Very good. How many people within their organization have had peer-to-peer job observations done as opposed to supervisor, superintendent, and worker? Any peer-to-peer PJOs going on? Henry? Yeah? Much? Or is that something you've had? How do you instill that belief?
Become a mindset for some of the sites, right, because they've gone through a lot of training courses. So it's not just, it helps the labor to understand the fact that it's not just supervisor just looking at you and trying to make sure you're okay. So you got to let them know that they can turn around and look at the supervisors or the operator or anybody else on site, because they all have responsibilities.
Right, I think it's important. This sort of speaks to called the care principle, where you look out for your co-workers and whatever. If you can get peer-to-peer land job observations going on between your workers doing a task, you're well on the road to having a very safe, you know, well-functioning work that's out there in the field that's not only looking out for themselves, but looking out for their co-workers as well. And that becomes very important when you've got different levels of experience working on the same task. That's not necessarily the old guy looking after the young guy. It could be the young guy looking after the old guy who's got bad habits. So the first goal is to help think about trying to get into doing peer-to-peer plan job observation. Okay, room here. Do you personally complete a JSA quality assessment evaluation? 70% have done that. If you visit the post website for updated safety information throughout the year,
yes,
21% of you aren't looking at the website for updates. It's a live site. There are postings that are made, there are changes that are made to the forms and procedures and bulletins and safety alerts that are on the website. So if you're part of that 29%, I encourage you to move forward with the yes column and have a look at what we've got going on there. You can do it at home. You know, everybody, I'm sure, has got a computer at home. I know you don't want to work when you're at home, but it doesn't take long to just go on with a quick plug and hope this improves on it. So
alluded to, a few of these, but I think near misses are a reflection of attitudes and improper procedures in the field. We get directed by peer to peer. So near miss formally.
What do you think about the incident triangle? You know, the near misses are the ones that are down near the bottom of the triangle. And ultimately, if you reduce the number of near misses, like if you can capture the near misses and learn from them, as you're suggesting, you're increasing, I guess, decreasing the probability of having a serious injury or a fatality. Near miss reporting has been a challenge probably for every company that's in this room. I know it was a challenge for us at SO to get people to report them, because there's always that fear of repercussion. And it's important for you to make your employees understand that there is no negative consequence for reporting near misses. They need to be identified and viewed as an opportunity to learn and improve and help improve the safety of all the workers on the job site. It's not an attempt to say that this contractor is performing bad or this individual is performing bad. May ultimately come to that sometimes if you get one person that's having a near miss every day, you know, so it's something wrong. That really needs to address that individual's attitude towards safety. But typically, what it is an opportunity to learn. For example, you know, a tow board with a scaffold and, you know, and a mason kicks a brick over, didn't hit anybody, could have, but it reinforces the need to ensure that you've got your tow boards in place when you're doing that sort of activity. Let's quickly do some of the technical ones that we won't spend a lot of time on, because we'll do the level 2, we should get 100% on every one of these questions. Because you have to get 100% of shots, right? Okay. Question 1, ear protection. A person can suffer permanent hearing damage after 15 minutes of unprotected exposure to noise levels. How many decibels?
90, 100, 110, or 120?
Okay. 90 decibels prolonged exposure will cause gradual hearing loss. But the unprotected 15 minutes to a noise level 100 will cause potential permanent damage. Okay. So think about the hearing protection. I know John was talking about hearing protection in his presentation. You know, we've got the single protection requirements, we've got the double hearing protection requirements. I know the noise levels of the equipment you're using on site. Think about it specifically if you get into a confined area, you know, in a car wash, for example, it's gonna reverberate more and more. So the same tool in a car wash can create a higher noise level than outside the car wash. So I've seen job sites where they've had the tools, individual tools tested by the noise meters or whatever in the various locations and posted signs accordingly to identify whether single or double hearing protection were required. I think it's important with the single, especially with the little foamies that you put in, that people understand how to use it properly. That's probably still a bit the biggest failing I've seen on job sites when you go out there and talk to people is they look like Frankenstein. They're sticking out and doing absolutely no good at all. They think they are. Studies that have been done on the effectiveness of those foamies versus what their advertised protection levels are indicates that they get about 120 of the hearing protection that they say they would get. So it's something to be careful about. Next. Okay, there's the combination of the chart. I don't see that one. Accident statistics suggest that about 50% of deaths in confined spaces have resulted from A, pulmonary entrapment, oxygen deficiency, vehicle interference, or equipment failure. That's great. The equipment failure, I guess, you know, that's an interesting one, that got 14%. That probably speaks to the effectiveness of the test group, you know, gas testers, or the way that we're measuring levels.
I would guess.
It's important that you have proper calibrated tools. But oxygen deficiency is the biggest cause. Enclosed spaces must be monitored sheets would have to be attached to the JSA. Why do we want them attached to the JSA? Access. There's no point in having an MSDS in a binder that's this thick, sorry, SDS, in a binder that's that thick that when somebody requires attention, saying you have to go leafing through to find what the corrective action should be if they got something in their eye or on their skin or whatever. It's important that you discuss that treatment in the preparation of your JSA. If you're handling something that is toxic or has a potential to cause skin irritation. So make sure the workers that are using that compound know how to treat any incidental contact with someone who may have hurt the crop. Yeah.
Something in the wellness point
good team.
It says you can have electronic SDS sheets. You don't have to have hard copy. To me, that was a have the ability to get them even on the site that they're on having accessible. Yes.
I'm inviting you for it. But, John, maybe you want to comment on that one?
I think change a couple of things, and I have my own personal opinion, but I hear you just quite right. It's a recommendation that the hard copy it's like a requirement for hazardous product inventories, and I would always recommend you have a hazardous product inventory just as a good practice. You want to know what you've got on that site.
So,
but they eliminate that one.
You have to remember that. In our industry, specifically now, we've gone beyond the minimum standard. I think what even the material that John was presenting, he was still referring to the, you know, the legal definition of material of 10 feet, you know, and we're at 6 feet, 1.8 meters. So we've gone beyond the expectations for the height definition. So likewise, in similar other areas of our business, gone above and beyond because of, you know, experiences or things that we've been, you know, exposed to, taught us, as you know, some good momentum that we need to focus on a little bit as well. In fact, having the MSDS, or the SDS readily available and attached to the JSA, Brian, as opposed to just the way I think it's quite a good one. Otherwise, it won't get discussed. Okay, next question. Can you use a pre-filled JSA? That's surprising.
I was going to ask if I might
start. I should have said start. If I said start, what would the number be?
Yes. A lot more, yes.
A lot more?
Yes.
Okay. What's the difference between a starter JSA and a pre-filled or canned JSA?
You still have to put his foot
in both. Well, the canned JSA is definitely not going to deal with site-specific issues. A starter JSA won't necessarily deal with all the site-specific issues. It'll give you the base case, but you need to potentially expand it. Starters are a base, okay? It's not a complete definition, okay? Remember that. You saw the drop-down list that NEE has set up. That's a great initiative. I know some of the other companies that have done an awful lot of work on starter JSAs. I know Playbar, for example, has done an awful lot of those. I think it started more in your environmental end, Brian, than the construction end. But, you know, it goes a long way to building your JSAs to help the workers in the field. And it just does, in some respects, it really does promote the use of your superintendents or your job sites having laptops on site to be able to access this information easily. Okay, atmospheric testing equipment. How often should it be asked for you to be dealt with calibrated?
Looks like we're about to do the same monthly. The correct answer is every 3 months.
Coming up that way. It is 3 months.
So,
it is done once a month. It's every 3 months. There may be some equipment that has to be done every once a month, like the Drager tubes or whatever. One last question, and then I'm going to turn it over, and then we'll get on to something else. We saw co-worker doing this. What would you do? Would you advise them on that hazard and complete a near-miss hazard ID? Ensure that they complete a worker heights checklist. Advise them on the hazard and move on to JSA. Ensure they complete a critical lift checklist. Exactly. That was pretty good. That's a solid answer. This is a near-miss. This is the thing that we've been talking about before, the need to report near-misses. Glad everybody knows how to use a step ladder. How often do you see people up at the very top? John was talking about it, isn't it? John was reaching on a step ladder, overreaching and falling off, and you know, less than 18, I guess, a lot of people die. You know, and I think we talked before about, you know, when you fall, you can die from a fall from some of those 3 feet.
Well, here's a good example of your concern for near misses. So here's a concern on that near miss report. So someone sees an employee doing that and says, oh, that's really stupid. He tells them it's stupid. He fills in a near miss report. Management has to look at that, decide what to do with that, and explain the situation. But there's that fear of a different repercussion that could happen because of that. Is there any thought process to give it like a near-miss report to stay a little bit more anonymous in terms of what you saw and what you did? And maybe that would increase some of the near-misses.
I don't think there's a need to have a near-miss report to identify your name at all. I think the important thing is to get the near-miss reported. The individual near-misses do not necessarily, it's not enough information, it's a change of report. Because I think it's simply being one-offs. Need to do is gather the data on the near misses that they're getting and assess them to find out what your biggest risk area is that you need to pay attention to. Because if you've got a near miss type that's occurring frequently, that says you've got a problem. And that's where you need to dig in and find out what you need to do as management to correct that situation. It's not fire somebody or give them time off or anything like that. It's like a real serious issue like this. What you need to gather the data. So the analysis that you do with your near misses is very, very critical. So hopefully, as management of your organization, you're gathering that information and assessing it and seeing if you need to take corrective action. You've got to get people to report.
Obviously, you're looking at a situation like this with the issues, for example. I understand you're saying, that's a very systemic, you know, hey, there's a problem here, we can address it. A situation like that. That has to be. I'm not necessarily going to be the person who you think but needs to be able to put there at the site.
Absolutely. That incident could happen like that.
Yeah. The supervisor needs to go up and say, you know, you can't do something. If I know you're going to do it bad or not, it's a point of your employees. It's not your own. You need to take care of them.
Well, you know, if I saw enough blood of that happening by standing at the top of the top of a step ladder, I would investigate or try and assess internally in my organization whether or not I wanted to use that different step ladder at all, or whether I wanted to replace them all with flat one ladders. Something to look at. Sorry?
I think it's important to invest in workers' name on them, because that worker might move to the next job, and then what if that's the next job? And so within the office, whether they're going to have some anything for us,
I think the issue that was being addressed more was the person doing the reporting, his name, reporting of the near miss. I mean, there's two things here. One is to get the individual to report on himself, and the second is to get somebody to report on somebody else. So there's two really types of reporting issues around near misses. And I think, you know, reporting on yourself is one thing. I think the name is fine there.
much of the peer-to-peer group, I think more into the first time of their stuff, but the peer-to-peer, there's two ways that happens. One is by the nearest reporting, the other one is just by going up and talking to the individual and caring about their safety and correcting the risky situation. And I would venture that 90% of those are not getting near miss reports. But the corrective action is being taken internally by the peer-to-peer discussion, which is fine. Management isn't learning from that, but the nearest safety is speeding up.
I think I've run out of a bit of time. We've got another speaker yet to come. So,
thanks for the participation. I hope everybody saw something and understood where your organization may be at, where the mood is at. Back to GPS and awareness of some of these stuff that's out there. Pay attention to it and see what you can do to make things better. So, look out for the job. Thanks.